You are now in northern England. The moors is my domain, with my household of one brother, whom I've locked in the attic, and my wretched sister. I've just brought on a governess to be in my household, although I have no children. And I have been seducing her with letters that I've been writing, posing as a man. I've now just brought Emily out to my favorite spot. Welcome to the moors. So, what do you think?
It's rather large.
Yes.
And cold.
Yes.
One might get lost out here so easily.
One wrong turn, and it's all over.
I don't even know where the house is.
One could look around in all directions and see no sign of civilization whatsoever.
Does it not seem very lonely to you?
I find it rather comforting.
Comforting?
I cannot stand weakness. I cannot stand it in myself, and I cannot abide by it in others. There's no weakness in the moors. I look around, and I am surrounded by merciless strength.
But mightn't it turn on you? Mightn't you be devoured by it?
Yes, absolutely.
The maid said you bricked Master Branwall in the attic.
Which maid?
Maidry? Mallory. Is it untrue?
No. No, all true.
That's horrible.
Why? Why is it horrible?
Oh, well, he was your brother, wasn't he?
He gambled. He deflowered virgins. He ran up considerable debts.
So you chose to punish him for his ungodly ways?
No. One gets tired of cleaning up after others. And then one wishes to be rid of them.
That's it.
After father died, Branwell's indiscretions became particularly irritating. Life became much less irritating when Branwell was in the attic.
Is he dead?
I gave him a loaf of bread. Of course. One can't live off of one loaf for 3 months, can they?
You are very heartless and cruel.
No! That is a common fallacy on the sake of humanity. It is our strength that gives us cruelty. Is one coddled in the moors? No. A bird, a fox, a dragonfly, it must survive off of sheer strength and will alone. And does one call the moors cruel, heartless? No. Inhospitable, perhaps. But that is their nature. And it is by accepting it, nay, embracing it, that one might feel truly at home here.
You are unlike anyone I have ever met.
What do you make of it?
Did you truly write those letters?
I did.
And you read my letters?
Of course.
Did you read them in the parlor, or did you wait until you were in the privacy of your bedchamber?
Oh. I chose
privacy of my bedchamber. And did they delight you?
I found it very instructive.
Instructive?
I read a great deal into your character and its weaknesses, and how you find yourself at the mercy of the world.
But pleasure, Agatha, did you find in them any pleasure?
Have you ever had a love affair, little Emily?
One does not talk about such things.
One doesn't. You're right. One does not.
Strangely warm.
Did they?
A sort of pins and needles in all of my extremities, even my toes.
And did you like it?
Oh, it was very dangerous.
Did you take these letters to bed with you? Did you sleep with them? Against your skin?
Yes, maybe I did.
You did. You did so you could dream of him.
I might have.
You did. You did dream of me, and it was nice, wasn't it?
It was.
On the first night, at the dinner table, he had eyes only for you.
He stared at me with dark, bright eyes. He saw me.
And you were seen as you had never been seen before.
And days passed, of course. One does not move too quickly.
One does not, you're right. And then one night, I came to your room, and I stood in your door.
It was a dark night, only a hint of the moon.
And the roughness of my stubble against your palm,
against my cheek.
The roughness of my hand.
It was a dark night, I couldn't see.
No time to stop.
And I did not wish to.
You did not wish to stop? You asked me why I brought you here.
It doesn't matter.
Of course it does. I brought you here to claim greatness. My sister, as you know, is beyond help, the maid worthless. But you, little Emily, you will obey me. You will do so because for the first time in your short, an unremarkable life, you have been chosen over others.
There were others.
Master Branwell, as you know, is in the attic. What you do not know is this. While he is close to death, he is not yet dead.
Mallory brings him a thin gruel and pours it through the final brick as it has not yet been mortared. And she pours that thin gruel through his weak and waiting mouth. Why have you chosen to keep him alive? When you have a child, it will be my child. And when we are all dead, that child will remain. When I have. And that is Master Branwell's purpose.